everyone, and welcome to AEW Revolution Graded. My name is Jack from Cultaholic.com. It's exciting times because I think we had a pretty eventful show on Saturday night. But how good was it? There's only one way to find out, and that's by assigning each individual segment a fantastic individual grade. That's right, it's time for AEW. Oh, I should mention actually before we roll the intro that this is going to be more of my take on like how good everything was on the show. But if you're after a more comprehensive breakdown of what happened on the show, just kind of more play-by-play, then do check out my What Happened At video as well, which is already up on the channel. But yes, for now, this is AEW Revolution Graded. There was only one match on the kickoff show, or the buy-in, as AEW call it, and that was the Dark Order, Evil Uno, and Stu Grayson. I called him Simon Grayson on my other video. Right, let's get one thing clear. Simon Grayson used to manage my football team, Sunderland AFC, and didn't do a very good job, and he's burned into my brain, and that's why I call Stu Grayson Simon Grayson. It's a mistake I've made before. I can only apologise and promise not to do it again. I may do it again. But the Dark Order, Evil Uno, and Grayson against SCU, represented by Frankie Kazarian and Scorpio Sky. And before the match, of course, they told Christopher Daniels to wait in the back. They didn't want him ringside because the implication was they didn't trust him. Without spending too much time talking about this match, I'm going to give it a B grade. I thought the match was absolutely fine. It was a little bit light in places, you know what I mean? They didn't go all out because it was only on the pre-show. But at the same time, I thought there was little post-match segments with Colt Cabana and then Daniels pretending that he joined the Dark Order and then just charging and attacking the heels. I thought they were really good little fun moments that really elevated the pre-show. Well, it's exactly what you want to see on a pre-show, isn't it? So yes, B is the grade. I enjoyed it for what it was. Now let's get on with the main show. We start things off with an interesting choice to open the show, I think, and that was Jake Hager's AEW debut, himself taking on Dustin Rhodes. It was a bit of a different match in a way to anything we'd sort of see later on, because other matches featured either more nimble high-flying guys or maybe more high-stakes matches for titles and that sort of thing, with more of an intense main featured storyline running through them. This did still have a background, of course. The two have been feuding for a while now, but yeah, it was a little bit unique in the context of Revolution. It was a pretty hard-hitting brawl, actually, and we saw, well, not our only instance of blood on the show, but I think our only instance of accidental blood, as Jake Hager was bleeding from the mouth at one point. Ooh, right from his teeth. And Hager, of course, picked up the victory, which I think was the right call, after a low blow behind the referee's back, and then just choking out Dustin Rhodes. Poor Dustin. Oh, I hope he's all right. This gets a B minus grade for me. It was gonna get a B originally, but there's one thing knocking it down. What could that be? That's right, it was the weird kiss spot with Hager's wife at ringside. That was a bit uncomfortable, wasn't it, in 2020, with Dustin just forcing a kiss upon Hager's wife. Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't have heels do despicable things in pro wrestling. That is, of course, par for the course. That's what heels do. But it was weird to see the babyface doing that in a modern context. And it got a cheer from the crowd and everything, but I bet a lot of us watching it were a bit like, ooh, that's not the wisest decision. Still, there were some positives to this match, even if, you know, it wasn't the best thing on the show or anything. But it was still alright in certain aspects. For example, Dustin still looks fantastic in the ring. Jake Hager winning, I think, was the right call. And they continue to get his whole MMA thing over, which really sets him apart from the rest of the roster. Next up, Darby Allin versus Sammy Guevara, who had, well, on paper, a very short match, but of course, we had all of the pre-match stuff as well, which we're going to take into account for the overall grade of this segment. And the pre-match stuff was, of course, insane. It was absolute insanity. Darby with the immediate dive during his entrance, and then the second less successful, far more terrifying dive. And then, of course, Sammy Guevara with just a casual 630 from the top rope through a table on the outside. And that's before the bell had even rung. And then, of course, it turned into a very fun match as well. Not the longest match, as I mentioned, but that does make sense because even before the bell, they'd both absolutely destroyed their bodies, so they weren't going to last very long in the ring. And I think that all makes total sense. And the action we did get in actual match time was very entertaining. Darby winning was a good idea as well, I think, with the smarmy heel Sammy Guevara getting his comeuppance, but I'm sure that AEW have big plans for him in the future. He is so promising and one of the bright young stars of the promotion, alongside, of course, Darby Allin himself. This was a great, fast-paced match, and I think that it was a real sleeper hit of the show. Looking back afterwards, it wasn't the first thing that I remembered. I was like, oh, there was this title match, and there was this really good match, and there was this. But then when I thought about it all in order, it probably was one of the best things on the show. I'm going to give it an A grade. Can't really find any big negatives about it. And yeah, I just thought it was absolutely brilliant from both men. Next up, oh my goodness me, let's talk about that tag team title match. Kenny Omega and Hangman Page taking on the Young Bucks in just We'll get onto it. We'll talk about it now. This could really have gone several ways. And to be fair, all of the ways it could have gone could have been carried out really well. You know, no matter what kind of swerve they pulled on us or what kind of turn, there are ways that this could have panned out logically and excitingly in the future. And that's a real credit to the strength of the storyline behind this match. A few things that could have happened, for example, Hangman Page could have lost all of his composure and cost himself and Kenny the belts, furthering the rift between them. Hangman could have also just flat out turned on Kenny, turned heel, and gone on a heel rampage over the next few weeks, building up to the next pay-per-view where presumably he would take on Kenny or maybe someone else that he'd crossed on the way. And then finally, of course, we had the idea that I was most excited for, I think, even if it might have been the most unlikely, which would have been Kenny turning on Hangman and then joining up with the Young Bucks to form that old school heel trio that we know and love so well from the Bullet Club. In the end, none of that happened. There were no real swerves. The status quo remains the same after this match. You know, the champions retain. Hangman and Kenny are still a team, pretty much. There's still huge tension between Hangman and the Bucks, and of course, between himself and Kenny as well. So everything pretty much is the same, but it means it's going to carry on, and I'm really excited for that. The champions retained, and both teams really had to lay into each other to reach that result. It was a very intense and emotionally draining match. Brilliantly so. Absolutely wonderful stuff. Also, the match itself, the action of the match was really superb too, of course. But no, the real strength of this match was the storytelling and the conveying of storytelling through certain moves, such as Hangman dipping into Marty Scurll's playbook, Hangman using the one-winged angel because Kenny was unable to because of his shoulder, and also the Young Bucks dipping into Kota Ibushi's playbook, hitting the Kamigoye knee strike on Kenny Omega, which just riled him up and fired him up even more. This was, for me, one of the best tag matches I can remember seeing, certainly in recent memory. It's right up there for me, alongside Gargano and Ciampa versus The Revival from the first NXT TakeOver Toronto. Yeah, this match was absolutely superb. And I really want to stress this, as I mentioned, this wasn't just great because of the moves and everything. It was brilliant because of that, and also because of the storyline behind it. If they just had this match without the storyline behind it, it would have still been really good, but it wouldn't have been anywhere near as good as it was. I'm going to give this an A+, and for my money, it was the best thing on the show. Next up, the impossible task, the women's championship match between Nyla Rose and Kris Statlander. And I really felt sorry for both women because no matter what they did, they were really gonna have to do something outrageous to win over a really burned out crowd from that previous match. And unfortunately, this was kind of the dead spot of the night. Both women did put in a big effort, but unfortunately for them, it wasn't the cleanest match either. There were a few little terrifying moments here and there. But again, I don't think that was the biggest drawback of the match. I do again think the biggest drawback was the burnt out crowd. They really had to struggle to wring any sort of reaction out of that crowd at all. But yes, we do have to talk about those two terrifying moments. Statlander's superplex, which was pretty scary, and then Nyla Rose's avalanche beast bomb, the finishing spot of the match, which also was very terrifying. Thankfully, they seemed to save those moves. Credit to both of them for saving it when it looked like everything was going to go a bit awry. And I think even the recklessness of it may have made those sequences look a little bit more crunching and punishing than they originally would have. But obviously it's not ideal because things could have easily gone wrong. I'm going to give this a C+. It was probably the weakest match on the show, but I think it was the correct decision to have Nyla Rose retained so early on in her title reign. And I think that there are bright things for Kris Statlander as well in the future. It's just a shame that the crowd was so burnt out and that the action didn't quite go as smoothly as it could have done. Next up, MJF versus Cody, which, like a lot of Cody matches these days, wasn't the best wrestling match on the show, but really took us on an emotional journey. This was full of psychology, storytelling, and huge moments. Some of those moments, let's say, divided opinion. I'm talking, of course, about the live performance from Downstate and Cody's neck tattoo. And I'm going to say no more on the issue, and let's just move on, because he can do what he wants. He's a grown-ass man. But as I mentioned, this match did have huge moments, big sports entertainment-y moments, you know, things that'll get the crowd off their seats and add to the match as a dramatic spectacle, like the Arn and Brandy stuff on the outside, the stuff with Cody's injured broken toe being worked over by MJF and at one point even bitten by MJF, and of course, the finish. We had MJF begging and crying and apologizing to Cody and realizing Cody wasn't going to grant him mercy and then spitting at Cody. Cody with the two big crossroads. He had the match won, but his vengeance took a hold of him, or his desire for vengeance. Went for a third one. MJF gets out of it. Sucker punch with the dynamite diamond ring. Classic heel finish. Shades of like William Regal. And then obviously MJF just fell on Cody almost accidentally. And despite being a bloody mess, despite having his ass kicked, and despite being clearly the worst of the two wrestlers in this match, the worse off after all that punishment, he came away with the victory. This was a very dissatisfying ending, but sometimes in wrestling, you have to have a dissatisfying ending. You can't have the babyfaces win the big matches all the time, and I do think, deep down really, this probably was the right call. Cody, of course, had his big moment of triumph in the build-up to this match. Well, he's had moments of triumph in AEW already. He had that match against Dustin. He lost against Jericho, which was a down moment for Cody, but then he came back up again, another big triumph moment on Dynamite recently in that cage match with the excellent moonsault off the top and everything like that. So I think it probably was the right call to have him lose here, elevating a younger star on the card, who again, like people I've mentioned, like Kris, like Darby Allin, like Sammy Guevara, is probably someone who AEW really want to push forward in the future. Now, this grade might be more than a lot of people online. I saw a bit of a mixed response for this match. I personally really enjoyed it. That might just be because I kind of totally agree with the result, but I'm going to give it an A- grade. It was full of emotion and drama. I mean, look at Cody apologizing to individual fans on the ramp as he walked out of the arena. And I'm really intrigued to see where it goes in the future as well. So A- is the grade. And I thought it did its job. Next up, wow, where do I begin talking about this? Pac versus Orange Cassidy. And they said he was going to try, and bloody hell did he try. Now, some people are going to be very pissed off about this, about not only the quality of the match, but also the response it got, the huge response it got from the live crowd and from everybody watching at home. And yeah, there's going to be some people who aren't happy about that. And I'm really pleased because of it. I'm firmly on the side of the fence that this was excellent, and it paid off the whole build, the very organic build involving Orange Cassidy. Pac was really cocky coming in because he's Pac, he's one of the best wrestlers in the world, and he totally underestimated Cassidy, and it was brilliant to see. And it turns out, who'd have thought it, if you haven't already seen him on the indies, that he can actually wrestle, and wrestle very, very well. The only minor drawback for me would be the finish. The Lucha Bros coming out to brawl with the best friends and giving Pac the opening to beat Orange Cassidy with the submission. But at the same time, it does serve a purpose. It furthers that storyline between the Lucha Bros and the best friends. So I can't even hate that one drawback too much. I was gonna give this an A grade originally, but then I looked at it and I thought, I've never seen anything quite like this in wrestling before. I'm gonna give it an A plus. Let me explain why. The reason I thought it was so good is because it was done absolutely perfectly. You know, everybody loves it when the underdog suddenly has a chance in pro wrestling. Look at when Santino Marella nearly won the 2010 World Rumble, or years before that when Scotty Too Hotty bulldogged a heel Stone Cold Steve Austin and everybody thought he was going to hit the worm on Steve Austin, and then of course he didn't. But everyone loves it when this happens, but this was different. This was a more fully realized version of that. It was absolutely perfect for what it was. They hit all the dramatic beats perfectly as well to really milk every drop out of that crowd, who didn't need any encouragement, by the way. They were so raucous for this. And it was a really good match as well. The action itself was superb, so it gets an A+. And yeah, all aboard the Orange Cassidy bandwagon, because it's picking up steam. And finally, the AEW World Championship match, the main event of the night, Chris Jericho, because he's a heel, am I right? Taking on Jon Moxley. The reason that I emphasize Jericho's heelishness isn't just because I wanted to make a very clever pun. It's actually because this was a bit of a standard Jericho match in 2020. You know, he does all the things that he does in other matches like this. You know, the ring camera thing where he grabs the camera, ringing the bell prematurely, announcing himself as the winner. He does these in pretty much every big match he has these days. And it does sometimes have diminishing returns, but in this match, it did work. That's because this wasn't about Jericho being a heel. This was about Jericho losing and about Jon Moxley triumphing and fighting back and overcoming not just Chris Jericho, but pretty much all of the inner circle as well, who all got involved and then ejected, or Sammy Guevara came in from the crowd and hit him with the title belt and ran away. But then of course Moxley kicked out and overcame him, and then finally overcame and outwitted Le Champion. The slow reveal of the eye patch at the end to reveal that Moxley had been outthinking Jericho in this match was brilliant. You know, the reveal that, oh wait, I've got one good eye still, I can see. Bang, paradigm shift. It was the perfect way for Moxley to win this match. And he is, I think, the perfect new champion for All Elite Wrestling. Like Cody versus MJF, this wasn't the best wrestling match on the show, but it was full of storytelling and drama. And I think also it was a very, very well executed title change, and the correct one too. I'm really excited to see what Moxley does in the future. So this gets an A grade from me. Yeah, I'm really hyped to see what happens next. What's Moxley's reign going to be like? What's Jericho's response going to be when it comes on Dynamite? And what's going to happen in the future generally? And that is such a great goal for a wrestling show to have accomplished. Now, let's get on with the overall grade. Overall, this gets an A grade from me. I thought generally it was a fantastic wrestling show, but not necessarily because of the fantastic wrestling. There were several great matches here, just as wrestling matches in a vacuum. Orange Cassidy versus Pac, Sammy Guevara versus Darby Allin, and of course that amazing tag team title match. But that's not the real reason that this show succeeded. The real reason began several months ago. This show was built so very well, to a level that I'm not sure we're used to seeing very much these days in American wrestling. It had several slow burn storylines drenched in emotion, all of which culminated in an effective way at the right time. And that is all thanks to AEW's very talented roster and of course the team behind the scenes as well. Are there improvements to be made? Yes, the most glaring one in my mind is the women's division. I think that's still got several big steps to take in the future. Hopefully it does. But on the whole, I thought this was a very, very good show. Enjoyed it immeasurably. Not immeasurably, I can't measure it. It's an A grade. But yeah, I think my biggest takeaway here is that I'm really excited for what's next to come. Thanks very much for watching, and let us know what you think in the comments section down below. You can follow Cultaholic on Twitter at Cultaholic and on Facebook at facebook.com/Cultaholic. If you enjoy what we do, then please do check out our Patreon, patreon.com/Cultaholic, where you can pledge. And don't forget, of course, most importantly of all, to hit subscribe and to join us.